Why everything that's supposed to be bad make me feel so good? Everything they told me not to is exactly what I would. Man, I tried to stop, man, I tried the best I could, but
you make me smile.
What's your addiction? Is it money? Is it girls? Is it weed? I've been afflicted by not one, not two, but all three. She's got the same.
Yeah. You are in the right place. This is the What Is TWS podcast. My evening with Flan, Road to Recovery series. I don't know if you can tell from the background music, from the overall sound of my voice, but this is going to be a little bit more of an upbeat podcast than the last couple. To recap, my name is Flan, and I'm an alcoholic, and my alcoholism and dishonesty have led to my wife and 2-year-old daughter moving out of the house. And I've started this podcast to kind of chronicle my path to recovery from addiction and hopefully recovering my family. I don't even know if that, like, I keep trying to decide if that's grammatically correct, but fuck it though. So yeah, third installment. So far I think it's been a little bit, you know, on the dreary side. And right now where I am in life and where I am in the process, I'm a little happier, a little bit more optimistic. I have a little bit more hope going into the situation right now. So I think this is going to be a little bit more upbeat. The beat in the background, I've been meaning to like point out the music that I play. You know, of course, that was Kanye in the intro. The beat in the background right now is a J Dilla beat. Oops, giving the wrong credit. Not a J Dilla beat. This is a Pete Rock joint. You Are What You Are. And I kind of chose this because it was upbeat. I knew it was going to kind of help me keep the episode a little more, you know, happy. But also, I think that's where I am right now, you know. And a lot of the things that I'm doing right now to help with my recovery, you know, that's kind of been a theme, like, you know, that you are what you are. Like, this whole idea that something is wrong with me or I'm less than or whatever. Now, I just need to understand who I am and what I am, and then that can help me make better decisions about, you know, putting myself in situations that are either good or bad for me. You know, putting myself in the best possible situations to get the best out of me and avoiding situations that would bring out the worst in me. But you need to know who you are in order to start making those decisions. So, you know, I've been a couple places and heard people say, like, you know, the best thing that ever happened to me was finding out I was an alcoholic. And it's like, that's because that's the beginning. Like, unless you know what the problem is, unless you know what the real issue is, you might spend a lifetime trying to figure it out. Like, a lifetime, you know, just dealing with miserable situation after miserable situation, never really addressing the problem because you haven't identified or accepted what the problem is. So I'm in a good space. I'm starting somewhere. I've accepted and identified what the problem is, and now I can start taking steps to live a better life as the person that I am. So, I'm gonna take a sip of something. Hold on, let me not say that. I'm gonna take a sip of organic Italian soda. This passion fruit, strawberry flavor. Delicioso. All right. Yeah, so what's been going on since the last time we spoke? More meetings, meeting guys. You know what? Like, it's a really weird thing for me. I mean, if you've listened to the What Is TWS podcast, you know how, you know, like, struggling with this, you know, new age masculinity or, you know, the way I was raised versus what's socially acceptable now. And, I got to come home. It's, like, weird for me to, you know, to come home and, my wife and I have been talking a lot, but, you know, so I'll be telling her about what's going on in terms of my my treatment and my meetings and my recovery. And, you know, it's like every time I come home, like, yeah, I got another guy's number tonight. You know, I don't know if I'm calling him or not. It's like, you know, like, you know, finding, you know, friends going through the same thing that you're going through, and like making connections and having people to talk to when you're in a moment of crisis is important. But like, for me, it means I'm gathering dudes' phone numbers. I got way more dudes' phone numbers in my phone right now than I've ever had before. And it's a different space for me. I gotta, you know what I'm saying? Woosa, I gotta learn to accept this new space. A lot of dudes in my phone, and it's, I don't know. It's new. And any of my friends will tell you, like, I'm not the communicative sort of friend. Like, I'm the person, if you need something, if you need me, and you can't get across in your voicemail or whatever that you need me, because I'm probably not going to answer the phone, I got you, 100%. If I got it, you got it, you need whatever it is, you know, I'm that kind of friend. But if you need a friend to, like, call you every week and, like, shoot the shit or whatever, like, that is not me. Like, you're going to have a hard time finding me or getting me to answer the phone. Like, you know, I grew up in solitude. I kind of like my solitude. Maybe I'm going to have to break out of that in terms of this road to recovery, but I don't know. We shall see. So I started an outpatient program this week, and it's like, yeah, the toughest thing for me right now in terms of my recovery is the schedule. So right now with my outpatient program, I'm going to meetings Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Thursday, and those are like 3.5 hour meetings. In addition to that, I need to hit other self-help meetings throughout the week, at least 3 of those. I still have community service to do, and then, you know, kind of in a co-parent situation with my wife, you know, trying to make sure I'm available to give her a break when she needs it with the baby, or to get my time with the baby. So the scheduling and just energy-wise, I'm struggling a little bit. I've been, like, crazy tired, living off Red Bull. But I'm making it. I can't complain. It's keeping me busy, so I'm not, like, sitting in this house by myself thinking this shit I don't need to think about. And, you know, I get encouraged every time I go to one of these things and get a little bit more of the message, get a little bit more of the encouragement and hope, seeing people that, you know, got 10, 15, 20, 30 years of sobriety. So it's very encouraging. And I come out of all of these things, you know, normally in a very good mood. So that's dope. Something I've been thinking about lately, because I saw this post before I, you know, had my grand epiphany, or, you know, started this path. I saw, you know, somebody, like, post something on Facebook where they were, you know, they were, like, dismissing the idea that addiction is a disease. So I think medically, you know, we've kind of transitioned into this space where you look at addicts and alcoholics are addicts as people with a disease. And this particular video I saw on Facebook one day was kind of like lampooning that, you know, kind of making fun of the thing. And, you know, and the whole point the guy was trying to make was, no, you don't have a disease, you're just weak, you know, you just make bad decisions, you know, you just need to be stronger and make better decisions. Other people don't end up like you because they make better decisions. And so, yeah, it had me kind of wonder. I mean, at that point, I was thinking, yeah, I probably have a problem, but, like, you know, I can mask it enough. Like, it's, you know, it's no big thing, and I'll shake this eventually. I'll drop it eventually. Like, it's just, you know, this is what I'm doing for right now. I'm good. So I wasn't taking it very personally, but it definitely caught my eye. Like, you know, I felt some kind of way about it. And so now, you know, in my outpatient program, one of the things we've discussed already is the idea of addiction as a disease. And I've learned some interesting things. I can't really try to repeat it because I'm not, like, I was paying attention, but I wasn't paying attention. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was going over my head a little bit, and it was long as shit. So it was like I was hearing the first half, and then the second half, I might have been watching, looking at my watch a little bit. I can admit that, you know, I can admit that I was spacing out and waiting for dude to stop talking. But what I did pick up was that, you know, the process, there are people that have a propensity for it. There are people that, you know, are going to come in contact with a substance. And while some people might, you know, try it and be like, oh, that was cool, you know, for another person, it's a life-changing experience. You know, like, a bell rings and something goes off. So there are people that have a propensity for going a little deeper into things that other people wouldn't necessarily do. And then in the process of you know, that journey down to addiction, or that journey into it. I shouldn't say down, but the journey into addiction. Some things happen with the way your brain functions that does impair your decision making. That does make the urge or make the craving almost overwhelming, and you have issues with the part of your brain that handles valuation, and you may place an extreme value on something that you shouldn't place an extreme value on. But something biologically does happen to you that makes it difficult for you to make that decision. It's not like you're just weak. You almost lose the ability without help to make the right decisions, to make the reasonable decisions. You do have a mental health issue at that point. And it's not just a psychological issue. It is a biological issue. So I'm learning that, and you know, and understanding that because of that, that this is a chronic disease. It's going to be with me for the rest of my life, and I have to learn how to live with it. I can't. You know, the goal cannot be to get rid of it because it's not going anywhere. I have to learn how to live with it, and how to have practices and routines and, you know, and habits that contribute, you know, to my recovery, that keep me healthy and in the right track. And one of the things is socializing, is having people that are aware of your condition that can hold you accountable. So that's kind of the reason why I do these podcasts, and the reason why I'm like so open and honest with it, is because the more people that know, the more people that are aware of what's going on with me, the more chance I have that if somebody sees my behavior change, you know, if somebody sees me in a bad situation, you know, that I got more eyes on me now. I got more people that might walk up and say, you know, hey, yo, you know, don't do that. Or come on, man, you can make it, you know. Like the way I would see it is that, you know, if you didn't know me, you don't know me, but like, you know, if you just saw me at a bar and you hadn't heard this podcast and I hadn't talked about being an alcoholic and whatever, and maybe, you know, you just know that that's Jay Flan, you know, he has a podcast, you know, and you might say, hey, what's going on, dude? Let me buy you a drink, or let's have some drinks together, or whatever. Because you don't know what's going on, man. You might unwillingly, you know, aid and abet my fucked up ass situation. Whereas me being out and open with it and being public about it, now if you see me in that same situation, you might walk over and say, "Hey, dude, like, you all right, man? Like, you know, I see you at the bar. You're not drinking, are you? You know." You need, you know, you want to talk, you know, you would approach me differently because you know. So yeah, that social aspect in recovery is big, and that's how, you know, I encourage anybody that thinks they have a problem, or you know, knows they have a problem, that, you know, I think you gotta talk to somebody. You gotta let somebody know what's going on with you. Like, let somebody know if you're in recovery. You know, people need to know that you're in recovery because, you know, it's a chronic condition. It's not going to go away. It could come, you know, you could relapse. It could come back. And if you got people that know what's going on with you, they're going to notice it before you notice it, and might pull you back. So, yeah, I'm starting to have a debate in my head about whether alcoholism or whether addiction. I think I'm really making the transition between identifying as an alcoholic and identifying as an addict. I really think I'm an addict, and that in my case, alcohol was the easiest to get, most readily available drug. If it had been something else, I might have gone to something else. If I was, you know, if I knew a lot, I knew people that had coke, I knew people that had weed, I knew people that had heroin or something, you know, maybe I'd have gone that way. But you know, in my case, alcohol was the most abundant, easiest to acquire drug, and that's, you know, that became my drug of choice. So I'm fighting addiction at this point. And so I've also if you listen to the last episode, I talked about the kava. So I've made the decision, you know, I gotta stay away from that. It's a mind altering substance. It may be somewhat healthier, and you know, and not looked at the same way but it'd just be me transitioning from one substance to another substance. I need to find real ways to cope that don't involve chemicals. So, yeah, so the kava, you know, if you're the kind of person that doesn't have a problem, you don't have a propensity toward addiction, that might be worth trying out. Like, I definitely felt something, but for me, not for me. But thanks, sis. You know, I didn't know about it, and now I know about it, and no one is half the battle. What else going on? Like I said, this is a more upbeat podcast. I think for the rest of it, I think I'm done with like the purely alcohol addiction section of the podcast. The rest of this is gonna be me talking about like what's going on in my life and where I am at, why I'm in a better mood. I'm in a better mood because fantasy football wise, I am doing fucking excellent. I'm a damn fantasy football legend. I think people really need to just appreciate my genius and my skill level. Like that, Yahoo is now doing these rankings or ratings or whatever, and I'm like diamond, which is the 99th percentile. I've had 5 seasons where I hit diamond, so I'm nice. Like, if you got a league and you want some real comp, holla at your boy. I'm in there. But this week, I'm in the semifinals of the league that I'm commissioner of, and guess who I'm playing? My wife. So now I get to have a week where I get to talk about beating my wife, and you know, it ain't a bad thing. It's time for her to go down. Like, she finished second in the regular season. I finished third. She's ahead of me, but you know, I'm gonna whoop her ass this weekend. Right. I'm gonna whoop my wife's monkey ass this weekend, and I'm going to the finals. I can say that. Somebody going like do a little audio clip of that. I'm gonna whoop my wife's monkey ass this year. I can see this is gonna be used against me in a hearing or something one day. Fuck it though. But yeah, fantasy football, 5 leagues this year. Playoffs in 4. One of them, I just had a horrible season. But I'm in 3 semifinals this weekend. The other league, the playoffs are just starting. But I'm trying to come home with at least 2 championships. I think I can do 3. I think I can knock out 3 championships this season. And maybe a second or third place finish in the other. I'm not as confident in that one league. But fantasy football-wise, I'm having a great time. And it's like, I said I wasn't going to talk about it no more. But it's almost like, I don't want to say God is involved in my football thing. But I care so much about fantasy football that if all of this other shit was going on with me and I was losing, I don't know how I would handle. I don't even want to put it like that. Like fantasy football is so important to me that my wife could leave. But if I was losing motherfucking fantasy football, nigga, nah. You know, it's not quite there, but it's there. Like, if you added that to the other shit, like, at least I got football. At least I can watch the games on Sunday and walk away with a little bit of happiness from that. So yeah, fantasy football is keeping me going. The other thing, and I wanted to talk about this since I flew home for Thanksgiving. I'm an adult male. I have a wife. I love my wife. My wife is a beautiful woman. I'm attracted to my wife. But you know, I see things. I see what's going on. And I've been a dude for a long time. You know what I'm saying? I've been a man, you know, for 36 years now. I don't ever remember seeing this much ass on display in my life. Like, all of a sudden, all women wear like yoga pants or leggings. And we ain't talking about like I know back in the day it was tight shit where like you could see the outline, you know, of the ass. Like, the thing women wear now is like you can see cheek separation, cheek. Like, you, that's the, like, that is her ass. Like, that is, you know, this is a thin layer of something on top of that. You pretty much seeing the ass. You could just imagine what you seeing in skin tone. Like, that's what her butt looks like. Like, and it's everywhere. Like, everywhere. I can't go nowhere without just like, that's what everybody's wearing right now. Like, what has happened? I believe that at 17 and 18, with the hormones that was coursing through my body, I would have noticed if ass was everywhere. This gotta be a new thing. Where'd it come from? What's going on? Does anybody know? I'm telling you, man, I'm saying cheek separation, cheek. This is what I'm seeing everywhere I go, and I don't know what happened. I got a 2-year-old daughter. What the fuck am I going to do when she try to put on some shit? And then I got to think that this is a progression. Like, I don't believe this was the way it was when I was 20, but now this is the way it is when I'm 36. What is it going to be when she's of age? Like, are we going to wear clothes anymore? Like, how much further can we go? I don't understand. I don't know where the end go. Where's the line here? Where are we going to be at? It's driving me crazy. I'm just saying, if somebody can help me understand how we got here, like, ass is everywhere. Like, it is everywhere. Like, you can't, like, I don't know. And it's like, I'm a human being. Like, I see it. But you're not. But now we in the, you know, like, I gotta worry about, you know, sexual harassment and sexual misconduct allegations. It's like, it's ass everywhere. I'm afraid to. It's a nightmare. It's like the worst scenario possible for a human being. Like, I don't want to get caught looking, and now I've created a hostile work environment, or I've made you uncomfortable somehow. But it's like, what's a man to do? And I don't want to downplay, you know, women that are being, you know, affected by these predators out here. But I'm not trying to be a predator. Sometimes I'm not even attempting to look. Like, I'm attracted to movement. Like, my eyes are attracted to movements. If I'm sitting somewhere and I'm not, like, readily engaged in something and something moves, my eyes going to jump to whatever move. And probably by the time my eye jumps to whatever move, you are past me and now bad ass. It's entrapment. Like, I don't know what to do, people. I just wanted to express that. I wanted to get it off my chest. If any dudes listening to this that are feeling the same way, all right, let's start a support group. Let's talk. Let's work this out. Because I don't know what to do. I'm at a loss, y'all. I'm at a loss. The other thing that's been going on with me is I'm doing my community service. So, you know, as I've talked about, I do my community service at Goodwill. The Goodwill that I go to is an awesome Goodwill. I love the people there. Very friendly. You know, they're always, you know, grateful that I'm there, which is just shocking to me because I'm there because the court said I had to be there. Like, this is really not volunteering. Like, you know, this is mandatory volunteering, you know. But I've been doing that a lot, and I call him the meth addict philosopher, because that's what dude seems like to me. He's just super hyper, always talking, always got a story. Mr. Me Too, knows everything, but just, if I didn't know better, I swear he was on something, coke, meth, something. But he was talking to me the other day. This is a white boy. He was talking to me the other day. And he likes to talk about controversial shit for no reason. And somehow we got on, like, racism or racial issues. And then he started telling me a story about how he was somewhere and some dude he was with made a racist comment. And, like, he went off on him and, you know, started attacking him. And then people had to pull him off and everything. And, I knew, like, he's telling me this story that this is supposed to engender him to me. Like, I'm supposed to be like, you know, you one of us, you defending us, you looking out for the little guy. One, that's how I'm looking at it. So I'm already offended, because it's like, you feel like you gotta protect our honor, you know, like, yeah, you know. And that's probably on me. That's probably on me, like, taking it a certain kind of way, like, you know, you letting me know that you fight for us, you know, like a white person is fighting for us. I should be, like, super grateful that, you know, big brother is taking care of little brother. But you know, nah. And then the other thing that struck me was that, in a fucked up kind of way, like, that's one of the ultimate examples of white privilege. And I say that to say, like, if he's with his friend who's white, and his white friend makes a racist comment about blacks, and he reacts in that fashion, he's a hero. He's standing up, you know, for the little, he's standing up for the oppressed. He's not gonna accept these racial attitudes from, you know, from his friends, from anybody. You know, he's gonna defend people. He's gonna defend black folks. Whereas if I'm in the same situation and a white person says something racial and I react that way, I'm not a hero. I'm a hothead. I'm dangerous. I'm the most dangerous thing in the room right now. I'm the black man that's turned to violence because he don't know how to argue intellectually. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's not the fact that he can tell that story. I can't tell that story. I can't do that. I can't do that. You can only do that because when you go off, you're not looked at as an immediate threat if you're going off for the right reasons. If I go off, don't nobody care what the reason is that I'm going off. It's a black man going off. You know what I'm saying? Lethal force is authorized. You know what I mean? Like, I gotta worry about dying. You gotta worry about spending the night in jail. You might get an assault charge. You might get thrown out the bar. I might not make it home that night. So I don't know. I might have been in my feelings when he was telling me that story. But that's how it came across. I mean, I do always like hate when, like, you know, people try to tell you stuff like that. Like, that's supposed to, oh, okay, you know, so now I feel way more comfortable around you because you fight people to say stuff about black people. Like, you know, nah, bro. Yeah. That just showed me you don't get it. But yeah, that's my time at Goodwill. Like, I really just want to go there and, like, just scrub some shelves or help people take furniture out their car, do my time and go home. But you know, I end up in there with characters. Like, I, you know, it's so crazy. I just always, you know, you grow up and you see like movies about jail and people who committed crimes and shit like that, and it's like, you know, I don't know where I got. I mean, I swear y'all could tell me if I'm the only one that saw this stuff, but I just thought like the one thing you don't talk about is like why you in jail, what you did, whatever. But it's like whenever I go to these, when I was in, you know, the lockup, when I was in jail for the couple hours I was there, I'm not acting like I was in jail for no serious time, but I mean, for a couple hours, I don't ever want to go back, ever. But that's all people wanted to talk about. Like, I'm the newbie. Like, I don't want to be here. You know, I don't have no experience with being here. Y'all know all the rules. Niggas is using toilet paper as pillows and stuff, getting comfortable going to sleep. Like, I'm like, nah, I'm not comfortable. I don't want to go to sleep. But the last thing I want to do is talk to y'all about why I'm here. Or talk, period. Like, I don't want to talk. I just want to sit here, make my phone call when I make my phone call, and get home. I'm not trying to make no friends. I'm not trying to trade stories. I don't want to know how much your bail is, though. I'm not here for that. But that's all people do. And now that we at community service, and we all know that everybody at the Goodwill doing community service is doing it because it's court mandated. You know, it's you either trying to prevent going to jail or you on probation, pre-trial, you something. You did something, and you, so we know that. I don't need to ask you what it was. I don't need to know. I don't care to know. I'm not here because I want to be here and I feel like socializing. I'm here because I got these hours to do and I want to go home. That's it. I don't understand why, like, as the kid that grew up in the suburbs that don't know nothing about the crime or interactions with the police, I'm the only one like, shut the fuck up, do your time and go home. Like, I don't get it. I don't get it. All right, so we nearing, I don't know, what should be the end of the show. I do want to tell one last story. Normally I do the Flans advice, but it's starting to feel a little preachy. It's starting to feel like who am I to give anybody advice? Like I'll tell you my story and what I'm going through and what I may have learned since the last time we spoke. But as far as like trying to advise people on what to do, I'm off that now. My bad. My fault. I want to tell you a story. This is Bathroom Terrorist Part 2. If you get a chance, you know, if you haven't already heard it, go find the episode of What Is TWS podcast where I go over Bathroom Terrorist number 1. But I recently had another experience, and this was, you know, far more harrowing. And is that a word? I don't know. And I want to share it with y'all because I need to get this off my chest. All right, this is Bathroom Terrorist Part 2. So the other day, so y'all know it snowed in Austin recently, which is like fucking crazy, but it snowed in Austin. And that caught everybody off guard. Nobody was in any sort of, you wasn't wearing the proper shit. Like, wasn't nobody ready for snow in Austin at this particular time. But the night it snowed, I was going to a meeting. And I got off work, really didn't have nothing to do before the meeting. So I'm like, I'm gonna go. It's a P. Terry's. P. Terry's is a burger place around the corner from where my meeting is. I'm gonna go over there. I'm gonna get a burger, and I'm like gonna sit in P. Terry's for like 2.5 hours until my meeting starts. So I already knew, I'm feeling like I'm the one that's gonna look weird. Like, I'm a dude, I'm a black dude, I'm gonna go in P. Terry's and I'm gonna try to make a burger, fries, and a shake last me for 2.5 hours, and nobody get worried that I haven't left the store yet. So I'm feeling like all eyes on me, like it's about to be a problem. So I'm in there. You know, a burger ain't gonna last 2.5 hours. It probably didn't last 15 minutes. But I'm chilling, so I'm down in my shake, trying to drink my shake slowly. And I'm just people watching. Like, not like, you know, not like hawking anybody. Like, not like, you know, staring or watching any one person in particular. I'm just, you know, people come, they go. You know, people sit down, they leave, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, then it happened. In comes a man who seemed to be of Middle Eastern descent. That's all I can say. Trying not to be, you know, I mean, the story is racist. Like, the story is racist, so let's just get past that now. Story is racist. The dude comes in, he's of Middle Eastern descent, and he's got a bag, like a messenger bag, you know. And he just kind of like walks around. Like, I don't know, maybe it was the Middle Eastern descent that made him stand out. I think it was more of the fact that he came into the restaurant and like walked around looking at all the tables without going to the counter. So, you know, part of me was like, all right, he's just trying to figure out where he wants to sit. But then he sat down and he never went to the counter. And he sat down and he just started doing what I was doing, which really should have, you know, not been a big deal because I'm sitting there doing it. But he just kind of sat and started watching the people come in and out. He's just looking, you know, looking. I'm like, all right, you know, Jerry, you're being paranoid. Ain't shit going on. Leave the man alone. Then, out of nowhere, he gets up. He still ain't been to the counter yet. He gets up. He goes to the bathroom. Now, like, Spidey senses is going bananas. I'm like, he finna blow the place up. He got this messenger bag. He got seats full of C4. He going in the bathroom. This is it. This is how Flan dies. I die in an explosion at a P. Terry's on my way to a meeting. Like, this in the fucking snow and awesome. Like, this is it for your boy. I'm worried. I'm trying to calm down. But in my head, I had just watched this D-Ray Davis comedy special. If you haven't seen it, it's on Netflix. I think it's something like How to Act Black or Acting Black. Don't give me, you know, whatever. I don't know for sure what the title is, but it's something about black and acting. D-Ray Davis comedy special, Netflix. Fine, there can't be too many of them. But anyway, in that comedy special, he talks about like how some of these mass killings like could have been avoided if people like stop being afraid to say something is weird. Like you see somebody looking crazy, they crazy. Like, say something about it. You crazy. Why are you doing that? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, if a white dude shows up at a black church, you know, that and you ain't never seen him before for the prayer service, you might, you know, what's going on here? Something should go off. But we like so afraid to say something these days, or so afraid to even think it these days, that we don't do nothing and then the shit happens, you know. So whatever. So that's in my head. And I'm like, I know you're just being paranoid. Dude just went to the bathroom. You know, I know it's weird, but you know what I'm saying? People got other customs and cultures. They do weird shit. You don't have to understand it. You know, whatever. Alright, so I calm myself down. I'm good. But he's in the bathroom for a minute. And really, in my heart of hearts, I'm just like waiting for the boom. Like, I've resigned myself to the fact that I'm gonna die here, and I'm like, you know, maybe my wife will come to the funeral and she'll cry or something, you know. I don't know. I hadn't gotten to the point where I'm not going to be here for my daughter. I think if that thought had jumped in my head, maybe I'd have made some different decisions. But I was at the, like, everybody's going to be sorry. And, you know, they're going to be mourning me. And they'll forget all about the alcoholism. And it'll be Jerry was a good man. You know, like, that's what's going on in my head at this point. And then he comes out the bathroom. But this nigga comes out the bathroom. I guess he had on like 3 sweaters. He comes out the bathroom down to like 1 sweater. The other 2 sweaters draped over his arm with the bag. But it's like hiding the bag and his hand. So now he comes out the thing with like sweaters draped over his arm. I can't see his hand. I can't see the bag. Now I'm like, no, he's not going to blow us up. He about to shoot the motherfucking place up. We all finna die. That's where I'm at. I'm like, this is really about to happen. He gonna shoot this place up. You know, in the explosion, I had a chance of like the shit just blow up, and I don't feel nothing. Like I barely hit a boom. And it's, you know, I'm gone. But like my luck, like he'll get the shooting and like catch me in the stomach or something, and then like come over and see me like bleeding out. And like shoot me in the head. I'm going through all of this is happening. Like I'm imagining myself at Columbine, and I'm one of the kids, and I'm seeing the whole shit, you know, go off in my head like a movie. This is exactly like the first time. So dude sits down, and again, so he still hasn't been to the counter. He's come in, sat down, gone to the bathroom, disrobed or whatever, came back out. And he still hasn't been to the counter. And he sat back down. So now I'm like, you know what? I don't want to die. Not tonight, Lord. It ain't going to be me. So I'm, you know, and I'm like trying not to panic or look like I'm panicked. Because I feel like if I look like I'm panicking leaving, he's going to realize that I know what he's about to do. And it's going to set him off like immediately. Like he still hasn't done it. Maybe he's waiting for the right time. I need to sneak out before that right time. You know what I mean? Like, and just not make myself look too crazy as I'm leaving. So I get up, put my tray away, you know, try to do that calmly and peacefully, you know, come back, get my jacket, get my bag. And I got at this point probably another hour before my meeting starts. But I've decided I'm gonna go out in this snow in Austin that I'm not dressed for, and I would rather be out in the snow with nowhere to go for an hour than to stay in a restaurant and become a victim of the P. Terry shooting of 2017. So I get up, and then when I get up, like it just keeps getting worse, people. When I get up and start walking toward the door with my bag and coat on, he gets up and he puts one of his sweaters back on. Like it's like it's almost like he read my mind. Like, oh, he know what's getting ready to go down. Let me get back up. I gotta do this now. And he starts walking toward the door. Now, that's where I'm going to end the story, because nothing happened. I got out the door. I walked, like, I don't know, 4-5 blocks down in the snow to McDonald's, got some coffee, sat there and waited until it was time to go to my meeting, and went to my meeting. I guess he wasn't a shooter, you know, whatever. I apologize to the people that was in the P-Terry's, because I didn't warn nobody. Like, I ain't tap nobody. Like, my man is weird. Like, you might want to, you know, you only got 2 bites, just go ahead and, just, you know, and get up out of here. Like, I didn't let nobody know nothing. I just dipped. So if it had gone down, I guess I would have had to live with that I just let them people die in there. But fuck it, though. I don't know. But that's Bathroom Terrorist Part 2. I'm trying not to be, I'm asking God to remove this from my heart. I see these people and I immediately had these thoughts. But I don't think it had to be the Middle Eastern descent. I think that added to it, definitely. But I think anybody had come in there acting that weird, it would have set off something. It would have set off something. I don't know. But all right, that's my story. As always, I appreciate y'all listening. I'm just sharing. This is therapy for me. If you can take anything from it, that's awesome. That's super dope. But until we speak again, be safe and be the light. Thank you.